You're listening to Getting Things Done, the official podcast of the David Allen Company, with David Allen being interviewed on the Tragedy and Hope broadcast. Welcome everyone to Getting Things Done, or GTD. My name's Andrew J. Mason, and this podcast is all about helping you on your journey learning the art of stress-free productivity. Today's podcast is an engaging and inspiring interview with David Allen by Tragedy and Hope Broadcasts. It explores the key principles of GTD and how to make informed choices with ease. The interviewer, Richard Grove, is a GTD enthusiast himself, and his intelligent questions make this interview particularly interesting. There are also hundreds of other conversations like this one available over at gtdconnect.com. And now, we hope you enjoy this special interview with David Allen.
But I wanted you to speak, I guess, generally about clearing mental RAM, using this space for thinking only about things once if it's meaningful, and then using the method to be able to clear more space and get more things done because you can have more productive thoughts.
Yeah, well, one way to think about this methodology is it produces the condition for you to flourish. And, you know, I love that word flourish. I think it's such a great word. And most of the people who've implemented some version of this methodology would say the common denominator of people's positive testimonials is I was able to be present, and it gave me the freedom to fill in the blank. Freedom to write rock music, the freedom to use my imagination much more creatively, the freedom to watch my girls play soccer without being on my smartphone, the freedom to be able to be in the kitchen when I want to play there. So a lot of it is about creating that kind of space to be able to be free to do wherever you want to put your attention and wherever you want to put your energy. So that's the essence, essentially, of what you're after here, of getting that kind of room inside your psyche and stop using your psyche to try to do things that it just, as I mentioned before, doesn't do very well. So your mind doesn't have one. If it did, it would only remind you of things when you could actually do something about them, when that'd be useful to be reminded. But your mind is like this wild monkey. It's just running loose inside of there. It'll wake you up at 3 o'clock in the morning and beat you bloody about something you can't do anything about while you're lying in bed, you know, which is not very smart. And, you know, to your point too, Richard, you mentioned earlier, most people actually do versions of this already. So when people say, well, gee, David, you're getting too organized, or you have too many lists, or you have too many categories. And I say, well, if you don't think lists work very well, do you use a calendar? Sure. Well, then don't be intellectually dishonest. Throw it away. If you think your mind can manage that, but the complexity, as you mentioned before, of our life is out way beyond how many things are on your calendar. So just the fact that, gee, I now can use these tools to be able to offload that job of the psyche, to be able to free it up, to then be able to take advantage of my intuitive intelligence, be able to take advantage of being more creative, more innovative, more loving, more peaceful, more whatever the heck it is that you want, that you would consider the golden goodies of your life. A lot of people know how to do that. You know, in a lot of the corporations that I'm in, there's all kinds of leadership programs, and those are all fine and good, but most people I know that are in those programs go, I know how to do that. I know how to mentor. I know how to, I just don't have time. I don't have the space. I don't have any bandwidth to do that. So one of the best things you can do in terms of your ability to be a leader is to make sure you've got clear space. And also, that's also going to engender trust. So, you know, if you're going to lead me, I want to trust that if I toss something to you that I think is potentially relevant information, that you're not going to lose it or fall through the crack.
Absolutely, because it puts your mind at rest, at ease. And this comes back to the value of clear space, because I find for instance, my email inbox, most people do still get email. And a lot of people I know have, many, many thousands of emails in the inbox, and they haven't discovered creating folders and being organized. But the serenity you get from having your email at zero, knowing that things are either in process or scheduled or whatever it needs to be to put your mind at rest, is invaluable. And what I see is a lot of people are addicted to the random schedules of positive reinforcement that email and other things on the internet bring, and that robs them of their time. And due to the content of this show, I give out a lot of homework where people need to reprioritize their time and their habits to consume this new information and learn their way through it. And this is the same sort of habit that we're trying to break with email. If we can learn how to get control over our time as individuals, then we can make time to learn things like these useful methods that that we kind of, you know, share with the audience.
Yes, as you mentioned before, that one of the ways to get addicted to anything is random positive reinforcement, which is what email and social pinging and all that stuff is doing for people. And most people are living in oh, I don't want to miss anything mode. I don't want to miss anything. This might be important. This might be critical. This might be something I need to see. And this might be, and so they're constantly checking. They're constantly checking about all that stuff. And that's a huge distraction. If you zeroed out your backlog every 24 hours, maybe 48 max, then a part of you doesn't have to keep doing that. Yeah, look, I'll get to it. It's in my system. I will get to it when I'm in getting to it modality. And in getting to it modality, then I can then sit down and I'm ready to now process my in basket to zero. So when I'm not doing anything else, I'm cleaning up because there's a surprise coming toward me I can't see. And when that thing hits, man, the last thing I want is any kind of a backlog, you know, hanging onto my psyche. So if I'm not sure exactly what I should be doing, clean a drawer, clean up your in basket, clean up any kind of backlog of unprocessed stuff so that you're as close as you can be to be fully present. So then you can evaluate the new thing, the surprise, the unplanned stuff against a really total gestalt. If I've got 300 unprocessed emails and I get surprised, that's called an interruption. And you get angry at the world for disturbing your well-organized life. If I've got zero emails and I get a surprise, I go, hey, a new opportunity to influence my world. Let me see if that's more important than any of the other things that I should be doing right now. So it makes me, I got a full team then in my head that can then make decisions about, okay, you know, where do we organize our committee right now? Where do we put our focus right now? And if you've got a big backlog or a lot of unprocessed stuff, that's almost impossible to be able to do. You'll be driven by latest and loudest.
Well, I've heard you speak in the past about the term open loops. And if you have all these open loops, these open tasks that you haven't done anything with and you don't have a method to do anything with them, that creates a polarity of all this unprocessed stuff in your head. That creates cognitive dissonance. It creates learned helplessness. There's all these situations that I see plaguing our culture in America. So it's, you know, how do we learn our way out of these things? And one of these, you know, the methods is how do you manage your time? How do you process the unknown and actually make it something productive? So now that we recognize that we need a tool for managing our life or time management or productivity or whatever nomenclature people would like to hang on it, let's jump into the fray of the battle and actually say that we're surrounded by an office full of stuff and we're overwhelmed and we can't be productive and I can't even take a phone call right now and my voicemail is full. Take the audience just through a sample steps. Don't give away any of your golden secrets because that's what you want people to consult and keep you writing books. But the idea is it's a general process that I think is very simple and basic, and you had to be a rocket scientist to discover this, and surprisingly no one else had described it this way, so kudos.
Well, come on, I'll give you the secrets. It's pretty simple. Get anything that's potentially meaningful out of your head and around your environment collected into one place. Sooner than later, decide what exactly those things mean to you in terms of outcomes and actions. Organize the results in appropriate categories so that you can step back and reflect and review your multiple horizons of commitments at any point in time, and then trust your heart or your intuition, judgment call about what you do at any point in time. That's the whole game. So what it looks like, that may sound like motherhood or apple pie or easy to do or hard to do. What it would really look like, to answer your question, would be if I walked in to work with anybody, and what I do is like look around and go, hey, what are all the things that you have attention on right now? What's not on cruise control? What's not on cruise control is stuff lying around your office that doesn't belong there permanently. Things on your desk, things in your desk, things under your desk, things in the corner of the office, anything there. And we don't tell people what's incomplete or what their open loops are. We just ask, hey, you got any attention on this? Oh, yeah, I need to. Okay, well, we just gather all that stuff and throw it all in the in basket. And then once we get all the physical triggers, because the physical triggers is a pretty obvious one right away. You know, pull out your wallet. Anything that doesn't belong in there permanently, throw it in your in basket. Anything in your briefcase right now. And I've gone home with CEOs before because they had so much attention on their personal life that it's sort of fallen out of control that we had to gather it all there too. It doesn't matter whether it's personal, professional, anything that's got your attention. We need to get that inventory captured. And so that looks like just gathering physically, just throw it all in an in basket and then empty your head. You know, once you get all the physical stuff, anything else in your mind that may not be represented in that stack. Oh yeah, I need to get in touch with. Oh, that's right. I got it. Oh, you know, I ought to. And would you grab all that? Now that takes 1 to 6 hours for most professionals to actually just gather all the stuff that they actually have attention on and where they put their attention that's not complete yet, that they can't let go of or that's not on cruise control. So that's quite a process just in and of itself. So that'll take, you know, half a day or however long it takes. I've taken as little as 30 minutes and as long as you know, 3 days truly to just collect all that stuff. So then you can't just leave it there. That's why this is a holistic process. You can't just do that. If you do that, now you just got a bunch of piles. Now you got a bunch of lists, and then you have compulsive list makers. They've got lists everywhere. They've got, you know, post-its on their screen. They've got stuff all over the place. That won't help either, because if you don't then move to the next couple of phases of processing and organizing, then the stuff will creep back up into your psyche because you won't have a trusted place. You know, it says, yeah, but you're not looking at the list, or it's under a pile there or whatever. So once we get the piles, then we need to reduce the piles to zero. And that doesn't mean finish all those things. It does mean decide what they are. And that's where we go through then, we have one at a time. What is that thing? You know, here's something in my in basket right now. My wife put in there. Oh, what is this? You know, so I have to pick it up and say, okay, what is it? What's the action required? And then, you know, once I make that decision, and by the way, those people looking at this right now, if you go through that process, if you get nothing more than the 2-minute rule, if you haven't built that habit into your life already, that's worth the price of admission, worth listening to Richard and me for an hour, if just to get the 2-minute rule. The 2-minute rule simply says, look, if the action item on this thing takes less than 2 minutes, do it right then, if I'm ever going to do it at all, because it'll take you longer to stack it, track it, and look at it again than to finish it when it's in your face to begin with. And so that's where you're really starting to build in Teflon, called don't let this stuff lie around. You know, make a decision. What is it? What am I going to do with it? And what's the action step required for it? And that's the process. And that process is a pretty simple one. Though most people avoid those decisions until the heat on that, whatever this thing is, forces me to have to decide on it. But deciding right on the front end then makes that available to me as an action to do in my inventory of all the actions that are going to move forward to close these loops and to, you know, move the needle about my life. So I need to make that decision. So first is capture. Then I need to go through each one and decide, is it actionable, yes or no? If it's not, I toss it, pickle it for later review, or file it as reference. And if it is actionable, then I say, what's the very next action on it? And is there some project I need to capture about this? If the one action is not going to finish whatever it is. So I then need to determine, to be appropriately engaged with this, if it is a project, I need to have a project list somewhere where I keep track of this project. What's the next action? And I need to track both of those until this thing gets completed. So that's where you generate what needs to populate your organization system. Outcomes I need to keep track of and be reminded of consistently. Action items I need to be reminded of so that I have the opportunity to be able to execute on these things easily when I'm in the context to do that. As well as, what are the things I'm waiting for? What are the things I can delegate to other people? So there's a lot of just good executive decision making that goes on when you actually empty your in basket. That's actually a lot of what your work is defining what your work is in the in basket. So the third thing is, you need to then organize that. So you can't leave that just with these decisions made without keeping track of it. If I decide this is a phone call I need to make to my bank, and I can't make the phone call right now, I then need to track, okay, here's a phone call I need to make, and I need to track that reminder. And that's why the organization phase comes in as phase three. It's not the first thing to do, because organization, if I'm trying to organize this but haven't decided this is a phone call I need to make, I'll avoid looking at this because I know there's a decision about it I haven't made yet. Most people's organization are simply incomplete lists of still unclear things, you know, and that then they start avoiding looking at because they know there's thinking and decision making they haven't done yet. They don't want to be reminded of that.
Well, I think a lot of people do this all implicitly, and I think a lot of people have really great ideas, and I noticed that without a capture method, without a notepad beside their bed for those thoughts that wake you up and say, I have a good idea, if you don't make a habit out of starting to capture and get that output going, you're kind of still lost afterwards. But I noticed after a couple years of doing that, I found it very productive. I was getting great ideas. And then I started thinking, I don't want to roll over and write that down. I'll just remember it. And when I'm having coffee at my desk tomorrow morning, I will, you know, remember that message. And that's worked very effectively. And then what I learned was that as a function of doing those habits, it's no longer necessary to wake up in the middle of the night because I'm getting all the relevant thoughts and planning and organizing out during the day, and I sleep like a log. And so I know you can't advertise, you know, read this book and sleep like a log because people get the wrong idea, but it's an effective tool. It contains effective tactics. And I think a lot of those tactics are around the building of habits. So I just wanted to add this quote to this very interesting discussion. This is from William James, and it's a quote about habit. It says, "Habit is thus the enormous flywheel of society, its most precious conservative agent. It alone is what keeps us all within the bounds of ordinance and saves the children of fortune from the envious uprisings of the poor." So would you be so kind as to describe the power of habit? I know it's not your book, but I know that it blends right in symbiotically, and I think a lot of people who have studied the nature of habit would find it useful in grasping on to getting things done.
Well, I think it was Alfred North Whitehead who had a fabulous quote that thinking should be reserved for special moments, like the cavalry charge, you know, where you save it for special moments. So whatever you can build in, so you don't have to constantly keep thinking, and you can build in these habits that allow your mind to be able to relax, knowing that it's going to do these behaviors then it saves your mental energy, your thinking energy, for real decisions you need to make and the real energy you need. So I know you mentioned The Power of Habit. Charles Duhigg's a big champion of my stuff. It's a fabulous book, by the way. And, you know, that book was worth its weight in gold just for the idea of a keystone habit. What is a habit that if I shift this little habit, it's gonna knock dominoes down of a lot of other things? Maybe it's putting on your exercise gear when you first wake up in the morning, like it was for him. In this case, the habit of emptying your in basket, getting that to zero, once you get that as a habit. There's still a bunch of stuff I resist, like the plague. I teach this stuff, but come on, I resist making action decisions. I resist doing all kinds of things. But because I have the habit of getting my in basket to zero, that forces me to do a lot of other stuff. If I said, okay, David, I'd like you to go tackle 43 decisions about stuff you need to do today. Hey, David, go empty your in basket. Those 43 things are in that in basket. And so by the time I get to the bottom, I will have actually done those things that I would have thought were much harder to begin with. So building in habits like keeping stuff out of your head, emptying your in basket, making next action decisions about things when they're on your mind. Whew, those things are real keystone habits, because they then start to impact a lot of other things that then you don't have to work on so much because it will automatically be handled.
It sounds so simple. Right?
It is. Easy? Yeah. Well, as easy as it is to change habits. See, Richard, I think the problem most people have is control is probably the biggest addiction to the human psyche. You know, the need for control. The fear of being out of control is probably the greatest human fear. And so I think people keeping all kinds of stuff in their head as a way to try to get control, but it's a very ineffective way to do that. So everybody thinks, if I keep it all in here, I don't want to write it all down because then it'll be really out of control and it's feeling so vulnerable to begin with. And what they don't realize is that keeping it all in your head is what's throwing it out of control. So there's kind of a paradoxical thing that you have to step through. That's why I said this is much like the martial arts or learning the banjo or learning the tango or anything else. The initial moves feel very awkward and very unnatural and very unnecessary. Until you do them 1,000 times, then you say there is no better, more efficient and effective way to move. So a lot of this called keep everything out of your head feels unnatural and unnecessary and awkward until you start to really catch how powerful that really is. So people have to step through those kinds of, I think that's the barrier to entry to doing a lot of this, is because it seems like that's unnecessary and it's going to feel awkward to sit, you know, to take every single email if it's not the most important thing in your world and sit there and make it and say, wait a minute, is that reference? Is that trash? What are you going to do with that? And actually making these kinds of decisions about things before the heat on them forces you to. That's a big habit change. And getting yourself to make decisions about stuff is, again, something that people can train themselves to do. You can actually train yourself to do it pretty rapidly. So it is simple. These are very simple behaviors. And the kind of paradoxical idea here is that these are behaviors everybody's already doing. It's not like they have to learn some new skill. It's not like a foreign language or a new technology people have to learn. They're already writing things down. They're already making action decisions. They're already using lists for calendars and things like that. So these are not foreign, you know, behaviors.
Well, I think there's a certain power in identification. What you're saying is it's overwhelming until we name it, until we define it and ask it a few questions. That ties back into the 2-minute rule about getting things done. And if you're going to open this email, be prepared to answer those questions. Otherwise, you're wasting your time. You're going to end up looking at it again. And it's running these threads down to a single thread. You look at it, you deal with it, it's done. And it saves you all those repetition times. So that's where the time savings comes from. Could you tell me, or at least share with the audience, what is the relationship between positive outcomes, priorities, and next actions?
Well, a positive outcome, any kind of an outcome that you want to achieve that's not achieved yet, that has value to you, is what you're after. And, you know, creating a project list where you start to identify things that are bothering you as a project. I need to research that. I need to clarify that. I need to get closure on that. And the positive outcome, you know, if you have your kid has a problem with one of their teachers in school, you know, it's nagging at you in your head. A positive outcome may not be to get the perfect teacher or have that teacher change their behavior. The positive outcome may simply be, look, I need to get clarity or closure on whether I can improve this situation or not. And so, you know, I don't want this to sound like motherhood and apple pie, new stuff. A positive outcome is go, look, I need to clarify this, or I need to handle this situation with this staff person that I've got, or I need to clarify the problem with the bank that showed up in terms of my credit line. And, you know, any of those kinds of things, the outcome is going to be what do I want to check off as done about this? What does done mean? The getting things done really requires two key elements. What does done mean? This is done when what's true. That's as simple as that sounds. That's a tricky thing to answer for a lot of stuff. What does done mean about this problem with your kid in the school? What does done mean about your vacation? What does done mean about the budget? What does done mean about hiring, you know, or changing your organizational culture? You'll know that's done when what's true. So that's a very challenging and very wonderful thing to start to build as a habit, to start to think about what is the thing that's got my attention, and what would resolution look, sound, or feel like? So just training yourself to think at that level, down at very operational levels or at very big, long horizon levels, any and all of that's really fine. And then what's the next action on any of those is the execution piece. You know, okay, now I've defined what done means. Get clarity about this situation with Billy and his math teacher. You know, cool. What's the next action? What would, if you had nothing else to do but that, where would you go and what would you do? Is that a phone call? Is that a surf the web? Is that a go to the hardware store and buy something? What is it? What would, if you had nothing to do but that, where would you go and what would you do? In other words, I know what done means, but what does doing look like and where does that happen? So now we've got outcome and execution. We have, you know, a positive result, and we have how do we move the needle on it? So those are two critical elements. And if you say priority, you say, well, you know, if you only had that to do in your life, that's one thing. But then you have to assess that against the 30 to 100 projects most people have. If you take my broad definition of more than one step outcome that you're committed to finish within a few weeks or months, get tires on your car, your next vacation, hire the assistant, look into a new cell phone process, you know, any of those are all projects. You know, and if you started to keep track of all of those, step back, and then you need to move the horizon up and say, okay, where are you going in your life, lifestyle, career, longer goals, life purpose? All those bigger levels of commitments are higher horizons that would identify commitments we've got at different scale. And you take a look at those and then go back to your project list and say, okay, do any of these need to move to someday maybe? They're a good idea, but they're not mission critical, or they're not something I really want to do. See, most people can't get it down to 1, 2, 3, A, B, C, high, medium, and low. If you want to get it done, God, you know, you want to get it done. I mean, I have two priorities. Well, you know, I'm talking to you and everything else. As soon as I stop talking to you, Richard, I'll decide. But I've got my whole inventory of possibilities. That doesn't mean that I need to, that I should give up, wait a minute, strategy for my company, strategy for my professional life, strategy for my personal life. I'm still thinking about those too, and I need to go through those kinds of exercises so that's not unconscious to me and I'm aware of them. But then I just need to trust my intuitive choices on the day-to-day, moment-to-moment, project-by-project. Is that worth it? Should I be doing that? So I'm constantly thinking and reassessing. But it's a lot easier to constantly think and reassess from those more strategic ways of thinking when you have all of those maps out in front of you, as opposed to trying to let all that happen internally. That's just impossible. You know, but getting them all out, that doesn't get rid of the challenge. It doesn't get rid of the risk you take. It doesn't get rid of, it doesn't make life easy. It puts your hand on the helm. It makes it a positive adventure.
Well, it's not the end of the journey, but it allows you to release from the dock and set off and start on your way, because you can't do much until you start to externalize it. And then you need to be able to organize it and prioritize it and review it and communicate it and actually get it out there in actuality to manage it. I want to take a couple minutes and dig a little bit deeper now that we've laid out the basic concepts and definitions. Talking about juxtaposing the ideas of control and perspective, and specifically, what are the five keys to gaining control in an individual's life?
Well, they're the five steps. You need to capture what has your attention, what's not on cruise control. So you need to identify that. Number two, you need to decide specifically what those things mean. What's actionable, what's not, what are the outcomes, what are the action steps I need to take. You need to then organize the results of that in appropriate places, so that step four, you need to step back and have the capability to review and reflect on the whole gestalt and the whole inventory. So that step five, when you then engage, you engage meaningfully, you know, from your intuition or from your consciousness or your intelligence. Now, that's how you get control of a company or your kitchen or a country. If you walk into your kitchen, I'm sure everybody listening to this has had walked into their kitchen and their kitchen was out of control. So what's the first thing you do? You start gathering everything that's probably not where it belongs, right? It's the food on the table, it's the things, it's the dirty cups, the glass, you know, whatever. And what do you do? You gather them all together. You put them on where they go. And then what are you doing? Okay, what is this? Now you're making decisions about what does this mean? Is this food that needs to go in the fridge? Is this still savable? Or is this, ooh, this is awful, that needs to go here? And then you're deciding what it means. That's a dirty cup? No, that's a clean cup. Then what do you do? Well, you park clean cups where clean cups go. You put dirty cups where dirty cups go. You go stuff that's food that's savable, you put that in the fridge. Food that needs to be thrown away gets thrown away. Now, I know this sounds dumb and silly, but this is the five stages you go through. I capture, I clarify, I then organize based upon what these things mean. I then put them where those things go. And then I step back and look at the whole gestalt and say, okay, now time to pull out the butter and heat the skillet. So then you engage meaningfully once you've actually done that. That's how you get a meeting under control. That's how you get a conversation under control. That's how you get anything under control. There's these five very different stages, but they're different stages. And each one of these stages has its own best and worst practices and its own tools. That's what most people never got. They thought, okay, I need to get organized and set my priorities. Yeah, well, first of all, priorities is something you're only going to set once you've done these five stages, so that you can actually have some stability with which to view your whole world, and some stability and execution capability so that you trust the decisions you're going to make. So that's why if you had to choose, do I want to get control or focus first? I say, well, get control first. You could either one. If you get highly focused on something, you will then go get in control in order to make that thing happen. So understood, there's a symbiotic relationship between control and focus. But if you had to choose, it's better to make your focus choices from a place of stability. Well, if your ship is sinking, you don't care where it's pointed. you just need to plug the hole, right?
Well, it's very much like setting up a camera. You don't want to adjust the perspective and focus on the camera until you get a stable tripod or some sort of stabilizer under it so you can get a nice steady shot. So juxtaposing this idea of control that you laid out, and I want to talk about focus and perspective. What are the six horizons that you've observed that pretty much apply to every individual I've ever met? And why don't we know about these six horizons already? Why did we have to wait for you to write this book?
I just discovered that there are six very definable horizons of our commitments. Very different content of these different horizons. You know, I'll start at the top. Top horizon is, okay, what's your commitment as a human being, or what's your commitment as a company? In other words, what's your purpose? You know, what's a raison d'etre? Why do you exist? What are you here as a human being to do? What are you here as a company to do? So purpose would be at that top level. I call that horizon five. And at the same level would be your values. What's really, really, really important to you, Richard? You don't care where you work as long as X. You don't care who you work with as long as X. And those will hear, what are your core values? Because your core values and your core intentionality or purpose are going to be your prime drivers. So there's a commitment at that level. I need to be a good person. I need to serve other people. And, you know, we're here to provide great education and information for people to improve their life conditions. Okay, fabulous. Now you got that. Now, how much is that going to help you decide which email to write first tonight? A little bit. You know, you're going to probably need to step down operationally to get some other horizons. So the next horizon down would be horizon 4, which we call vision. This is the long-term picture. Okay, if you were fulfilling your purpose successfully, what would that look, sound, or feel like? 5 years from now, 3 years from now, 10 years from now, whatever, 100 years from now, whatever kind of way long big future out there would give you permission to say, oh, if I could make it up, wild success would look, sound, or feel like this. I'll be doing this with this level of impact, with this level of profitability, with this level of fun, with whatever. And then you sort of essentially create your own movie about that. So that's the next level of commitment. Okay, I'm committed, and this would be lifestyle or career or for the company, the long-term goal or vision of kind of what business, how does it see itself in the world out there. And that could be much more specific and much more granular. You can get as granular as a two-hour movie about the detail of what that could look like. But how much would that then help you decide which email to write first? Well, a little bit more. But then you're going to probably need to back it down and say, yeah, in order to make that grand, wonderful, wild success vision come about, what are the things I need to accomplish over the next 3 months to 24 months? What are the goals, essentially, or objectives? And don't get tied up in the words, but it's going to, what's the shorter term things that we need to accomplish? Here's the 6 things we need to do in the company this year. Here's the 3 things my spouse and I would really like to have true by the end of this year in terms of our lifestyle. So getting clarity of that'd be what I call horizon 3. You still don't have anything to do yet. You're still, all you're doing here is defining and refining the images and pictures you've got in your mind that you'd like to have true. But then you need to back it down to what I call horizon 2. What are all the things you need to maintain so you have balance and stability of the enterprise to be able to get those goals and that vision? Oh yeah, we need to manage finances. Oh yeah, how about my health? How about my relationships? Oh yeah, how about my personal expression? How about my health and vitality? How about staff development? How about quality control? Now you get down to what we refer to as areas of accountability or interest or focus, and these are not things to finish. You don't finish growing sales. You know, you just need to say, is that being maintained at some appropriate level? You don't finish health to say, is that at some appropriate level? So down at horizon 2, that's where you'd have your job description. That's where you'd have maybe a checklist about your life. How am I doing with, how's my health? How's my personal expression? How's my family? How's my relationships, et cetera? So that's another level of commitment just to maintain. Essentially, what are all those things I need to maintain? A lot of your day is spent, as soon as you eat lunch, you just said, that's a horizon 2 thing. I'm taking care of my body. As soon as you take a nap, that's a horizon 2. I'm watching my energy levels and my flow. You still don't have anything to do yet. Now, how much have you clarified your purpose, your vision, the goals you want to achieve, and all the things you need to maintain? How much would that help you decide which email to write first? A bit more. But then you're going to say, okay, now what are all the things you need to finish about all that? Oh, yeah, I need to get a trainer for my health and energy. Oh, yeah, I need to hire an assistant. Oh, yeah, I need to increase my credit line at the bank. Oh, yeah, now you got projects. Projects would be horizon 1. Those are all the things you need to finish. As I mentioned, that's the 30 to 100 things, if you count personal and professional, that you need to accomplish. Or some part of you says, I need to finish all these things to maintain what I need to maintain and to move the needle toward the goals and vision that I have. And then you still don't have anything to do yet, by the way. Because you don't get to doing until you get down to the ground level. And ground level, as opposed to any of these horizons, is, okay, phone calls, emails, buy at the hardware store, talk to my life partner about whatever. Now we come down to the next actions. What are all the action, the physical, visible activity that needs to go on about any of these open loops or any of these things and commitments in order to, you know, make all those other horizons viable and aligned? And that's where most people have between 150 and 220 next actions at any point in time. The 13 phone calls you need to make, the 6 things you need from the hardware store, the 3 things you need to go over with your life partner, the 16 things you need to draft at your computer, got a bunch of those. Now you actually have stuff, real stuff to do. So when you come back to how did I discover this, you know, I actually came up with those horizons because I had a very senior guy in a big Wall Street firm I was doing some consulting and coaching in. that his biggest presenting issue was his calendar. He was just blocked for months. He had no room whatsoever. His assistant was turning to toast because she was trying to fend off everybody that politically wanted to get on this guy's calendar. And he closed the door. He said, David, what do I do about this? And I'm scratching my head. Going, I don't know. What do I tell this guy? And he had a whiteboard in his office. And I went up and I actually laid out these different horizons. And as soon as I laid them out, I said, well, there's this horizon. I said, at what horizon do you want to have this conversation about your meetings? And he went, I got it. Got it. He looked at it and said, this is not about meetings. It's about I got teenage kids that are growing up out from under me. And I'm going to miss that game if I sit around trying to make partner till 11 o'clock at night. Got it. So it wasn't about, so I discovered that it was very helpful, though we all implicitly have these kind of commitments, some more than others and some more conscious than others. I don't tell people they should set goals at level at horizon three. I just say if you got them, then you need to identify them because they're there, they're pulling or they're pushing on you anyway. So you need to make those conscious so that you don't break agreements with yourself. You don't have to have a vision unless, of course, you do. You know, so that's all up to you, how much and how conscious you need to be at these different horizons. But I guarantee you, the just your actions and projects, getting those horizons really clear will suddenly make it a lot clearer for you to be able to think of these longer horizons and bigger things to do that. And also, we found over the years, this is very helpful lexicon for people and a framework for people to have a discussion. You and I want to talk about the future of the business. I say, well, is this the big vision future or is this, you know, by tomorrow afternoon, what do we need to have true? And if you're doing blue sky stuff, I'll hear, hey, here's our grand vision. And I'm trying to get accountabilities for real projects that we've got to have to make sure that we meet the goals that we need to have to be able to make your vision happen. We'll probably want to shoot each other just because we're passing in the night in terms of the horizon we're talking about. So it's very, very handy to realize, look, we've got these different levels of commitments that we have. Ideally, they want to be aligned. And just a very useful model, essentially, to think about. And they're all commitments. They're all, you know, some level of agreement with myself that if the world is not matching whatever I'm holding as an inventory there, then I've got some sort of creative cognitive dissonance with myself. That's just nice to identify those maps.
Well, I think it's also providing a common ground for people to get on the same page by identifying what horizon they want to engage at on this particular topic. It's providing useful rules of engagement or best practices for what people, you know, are going through every day. And again, it's the power of identification, in my opinion, that makes making things explicit using the words and nomenclature that helps release your mind from that confusion and fear and unknown and start. That's where serenity starts, because once you have a method and you've started to name it, it's in the process and you just have to rely on your habits. So I want to build upon this. I mean, I know it can be overwhelming for some people because you've had a lifetime of not using a method, and then you take inventory and you're like, wow, I have a lot of projects to do. But it's easy to break down what's more important, getting food or fixing this thing over here that's been broken for 2 years. We're going to get food before we fix this thing. So it's also easy to become overwhelmed. And once you're unoverwhelmed by your own situation, you want to start working with other people. You might have to work with some people on projects already just to get through your list. So let's talk about the recipe for having a successful meeting where things actually get done as a result.
Well, these two words, outcome and action, are great to build into meetings. What are we trying to accomplish by what time today? And do we have the right people in the room to do that? I mean, I can't believe how many meetings don't start out with going, okay, what would be success by 2 o'clock? By 2 o'clock, what would we like to have true? Because if you don't actually answer that question, you don't know how to frame your conversation. You don't even know if you should be in the room until that's clear. So clarifying, what are we trying to accomplish? By what time? And a lot of people forget to ask that. You might want to accomplish something, but you've given an inappropriate time to do that. And so, you know, you need to make sure that's clear. By what time? What would we like to have true? And you don't end conversations without going, so what did we just decide? What's the next step? Who's got that? So deciding next actions, or deciding at least accountabilities for decisions that were made or results that then you agreed on in the meeting. Those two things, man, I've seen that change a whole culture when that starts to be built into the lexicon. Just what are we trying to do? Okay, and once we decided, you know, that something needs to happen or change, who's doing it? Who's accountable for that? And those two things themselves are extremely powerful. And understanding what the purpose for the meeting to begin with and why am I being invited. I mean, meeting-itis is just eating the corporate world alive out there. And, you know, there are so many that are just unconscious. You know, they just, well, we Monday meeting. Well, why are you having a Monday meeting? Well, because we had Monday meetings every week for 7 years ago. And yeah, but you haven't needed a Monday meeting. You haven't needed weekly meetings for the last 3 years. You know, so it's very easy for these habits to get installed and just the cows to run down the cow paths, you know, and not change them. So making these conscious, I mean, I guess that's the real critical element. Because meetings are fabulous. They're great ways to get a lot of really good stuff done, but only if they're managed appropriately and framed appropriately.
It always blows my mind how wide-ranging this set of best practices really does reach. The segment about different conversations at different horizons, and which horizon do you want to have this conversation at, triggered for me when he was talking about roles and responsibilities and areas of focus, horizon two, how there are a few things that I might not have on cruise control, so that triggered some new actions for me. And hey, if this triggered something for you too, don't forget that there's an entire community waiting for you to have a conversation and help each other through the process over at gtdconnect.com. Well, that's going to do it for me. But until next time, my name's Andrew J. Mason, asking you, what's your next action?